Well, it's truly wonderful to be here with you tonight. It's very interesting that I'm a failed student at LST. I came here once to do an MTH. I only stuck it for 3 weeks, 3 months, and then I turned it into a doctorate and went back to my old place, a little college on the River Cam. So I had to do with that. I was saying earlier, it's quite strange that I have 3 real doctorates and 19 pretend ones. You know, those they give you without doing any work. And it's wonderful to be able to come back here. And it's quite moving in a way to think that this was the place where I seriously started thinking about the role of Israel in the Middle East. It was this place, the lecturer at the time who was supervising me actually gave me the title for my first doctorate. No, my second doctorate. And that has gone with me for many years. Now, tonight is the Deo Gloria lecture, the glory of God lecture, when the reality of the presence of God with us is thought about. What does it mean to share the good news of Jesus in the midst of conflict? And it was very interesting, just before dinner tonight, I met somebody who I presume is here, who was with me in Baghdad when we just started after the conflict of 2003. I had been there for many years before, but that was when the work really started. That was when our church reopened. I never forget the first Sunday we reopened our church in Baghdad. It was shut in 1990 after Britain was dropping bombs on Iraq. Well, Britain and America. So it was closed. And I opened this church, and all of my congregation were spooks. They were the head of the CIA, the head of the MFI, the CB, what was it called? The FBI and the CIA, MI5 and MI6. We had Sir Jeremy Greenstock and Jerry Bremen, all these people. And I thought, well, this church is very spooky. Spooky being intelligence officers. And then I started a chapel in the Republican Palace, the US Embassy it had become. It was in the days of the Coalition Provision Authority. And it was quite an interesting place to have a chapel, because I had a very nice chair. I've got this chair today. Then I had a gold one, because Saddam Hussein had had it as his throne, and he didn't need it anymore. So I had it. We had pictures of Scud missiles going up one side of the wall. We had Jerusalem the other side. And there we were. That was where I first learned about the presence of God in all his power and all his might. That was where I really learned about serving God in the middle of conflict, in the middle of a war zone. In my former life, I was a gas man. That meant I put people to sleep with drugs. Now I do it with sermons. Now, if you start falling asleep, just let me know, because I know a bit about resuscitation, having run the cardiac arrest team. I'm quite good at getting back the dead to new life. And this passage tonight I want to look at is Matthew chapter 25. It's about the sheep and the goat. Matthew 25, verse 31. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne, probably like my throne in the palace. And all the nations will be gathered before him. And he will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates his sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. And the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by the Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" And the king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." Now, it's very interesting because, you know, I'll be honest with you, I've talked about it today. To me, the greatest thing about goats is goat curry. Now, if any of you are Jamaican, any Jamaicans here? Really? So you know about goat curry and rice and peas and dumpling? Yeah, man, you know, man, at the very heart of West Indian cuisine is curry goat. But maybe those goats are best curried if they've gone off left and right. You know, in the Middle East, where I spend most of my time, even now, these people who think I'm not there are wrong. I will be on Sunday when I go back. And the only difference between a goat and a sheep is a goat's tail goes up and a sheep's goes down. So what Jesus is saying is that these sheep and goats all look the same. But Jesus doesn't talk about their tails. He talks about what they do. You want to minister in a conflict area, you have to be able to do something real. I see that Heidi Baker, a good friend of mine, has given one of these lectures before. And Heidi says, love always looks like something. Love has to be real. It has to be seen. The very heart of my work is putting into practice what Jesus says. When they're hungry, do you feed them? When they're thirsty, do you give them drink? When they're ill, do you care for their physical being? And so the very heart of what I do, the one thing that Jesus left out in this reading was you've got to educate the children. And Jesus showed in his life and ministry how important the children were. And so at the very heart of our work is doing all of these things. I have a school. It's the best school in the world, actually. And people say to me, what's your school called? Is your school a Catholic or a Protestant or a Chaldean or an Orthodox school? I say no. Our school is a Masihi school. It's Aramaic for it is a school that follows the Messiah. For years we have worked on trying to get ecumenics going, trying to get these different Christians together. And one of the things about LST is that it is a place where all the different Christians come together as one. And when you get to heaven, there isn't going to be a side for Catholics and a side for the Protestants and the back end for the Pentecostals. They'll all be together.
Amen.
And with us, it was in the midst of our terrible persecution the midst of the terrible anguish of our people being killed and massacred, that they came together. You know, people say, oh, in persecution, everything's all right. It's not. Persecution can make things even worse. But in real, desperate persecution, we became one. And we are one. And so at the heart of our work, we divide it into four, our ministry. We provide food. We feed people. The major relief project. Food includes drink. We have a very big clinic, so provide all health care. We have a school and educate the children. And we have a project to provide housing for people. They're not in a refugee camp. They're in terrible, ramshackled apartments. Really terrible. I can remember one day, there was a little boy called Marcel. I had given them a house. I had provided food for them. Marcel's father had been killed by Daesh, and his family had fled. We call ISIS Daesh. He had fled to Jordan. And I put my arms around him and I said, Marcel, I will give you anything. What do you want? He said, Daddy, will you be my daddy? I said, of course I'll be your daddy. And I put my arms around him and said, what else do you want, Marcel? He said, I want a school. And children who were refugees from Iraq were not allowed to go to school. Do you know how long it took me to set a school up? 3 weeks. The longest I've ever had to do anything. 3 weeks. All these people, when you ask them, what are they doing? Oh, I'm waiting on the Lord. I'm waiting on the Lord. Which really is an excuse for I'm not doing anything and I can't make up my mind and I can't take any risks. Get on with it! Would you like to see a picture of my school? Come on, show us a picture, whoever shows pictures. Whoever's a picture shower here. I don't see the picture. I hear the sound of our children. Ah. Three times a day. Our children sing the Lord's Prayer in Aramaic. And there they are, all standing, preparing to go into school. And all of our children wear bow ties. Why? Because Abuna wears a bow tie. So they put it in their uniform. And as you see the children depart, they all walk straight down the line. They all walk absolutely in line. They never talk or shout or do anything abnormal. They're so good. The Minister of Education came to see them. He said, "This isn't a normal school. It's like a military academy." I said, "Yeah, it's good, isn't it?" So they're so good, our children. I love them so much. And when I go back, when I'm there, they all treat me like their daddy. They call me daddy. And if I'm late, if I'm away too long, they want to know why. The other day, one of the little girls in the class, she said, "Daddy," she said, "you've been very naughty." I said, "What's wrong?" She said, "It's all right you being too loud when you do your prayers and when you teach us, but you can't be loud in class." I said, "I'm not very loud." She said, "You are." So now she sits in class like this. Mabuna. So I'm learning to be quiet. The fact that I'm 80% deaf actually doesn't help the matter, but I'm trying. All the children in our school, as I said this morning, were all given a cross. And these crosses were made by a friend of mine called Joseph. Joseph is a carpenter and he lives in Bethlehem. So he's rather good at this kind of thing. So Joseph makes the crosses. All the children wear a wooden cross around their neck and have this in their pocket. And one day when I gave one of the little boys a cross, he started to cry. He said, "I wanted a cross for my daddy, but Daesh killed my daddy." I said, "Yusuf," most of our children are called Yusuf or Mary or Mariam. I got to get it right. Just like the Muslim boys are all called Muhammad, the Christian boys and girls are called Mary and Joseph. So I gave him a cross and I said, "I'm putting that cross on the altar. And that's your daddy's cross. And one day your daddy will know that his cross is there." When I leave the school to come to things like this, I say to the children, "What do you want me to tell everybody?" And they say, "Will you tell them that we thank them for their support? Will you tell them that Jesus loves me?" But this time, or a few months ago when I was there, Joseph said to me, Abuna, I want you to take my cross and I want you to give it to the people in the church where you're going and tell them this is my cross. So they better look after it well. So I've got his cross. I gave out 3 at chapel this morning, didn't I? And this one is for somebody here tonight. Haven't decided yet who's going to get it. You know, better wait a little while. Now, so our work is the work of Jesus. Doing all those things. And the only thing that I wasn't really so involved with until a few years ago was visiting the prisoners. And I was in Nashville, Tennessee. You know the place where they sing all the time? And I was with a guy called Michael W. Smith. Heard of him? Yeah. And there was a guy there called Joe. And Joe said to me, he said, Andrew, you need to come and tell your story to my men. I said, who are your men? He said, my men are the men on death row at River Bend Maximum Security Jail. He said, I want you to come and see them. So then I started going to these poor prisoners on death row. Some of them have been on death row for 30 years, waiting, waiting, and waiting. They have no idea when they're going to be executed. And all of these people, I went into them. And they were all Christians. Every one of them had become a follower of Jesus. Every single one of them. But just to make things a little bit more interesting, one of them was Jewish. And so he had become a practicing Messianic Jew. So he'd influenced the whole of the prison community. They were all wanting to be Messianic Jews. And I used to go there from Israel. This might sound absolutely crazy. I started teaching them Hebrew. Every prison cell has a mezuzah on the door. You can laugh. They all have talits. They all have their yarmulkes. And it's a very, in Yiddish we'd say, a very from environment. It's very orthodox. And they all love Jesus so much. And they all take the messianic position of following Yeshua. So we say Yeshua, They say Yeshua, but we understand each other. And one of my friends, who's an Aramaic Christian from Palestine, in fact, his brother-in-law has the pot that the Dead Sea Scrolls were found in. And they do these. So they are, I'm letting you into all the secrets about my existence now. My original clan, some of you joined my clan today, didn't you? And I gave you the bracelet that all the clan wear. But the original clan are all connected with the people who found the Dead Sea Scrolls. And all the people in prison on death row of the clan, and all the people who have the crosses are the clan. And it's wonderful the way that our Lord creates such important relationships. In my life, the most important thing to me are those who inspire me to do my work. I've got somebody from the Netherlands, not Holland, the Netherlands, doing a documentary about me at the moment, haven't I, Chris? And she said, all I see from your work, she's been out with me to Israel and Jordan, is how much you love people. And I can honestly say, my life is inspired by the people I meet and the people who spur me on. Now, I was in Liverpool recently. I never wanted to go to Liverpool. I thought, why on earth am I in Liverpool? I've got this son, Jacob, who's such a Liverpool fan. And my new member of staff, who's coming to be my head of staff, who's the director of French at Brentwood School, she's a Liverpudlian. But I had the best time I've ever had anywhere in England, in Liverpool. So I changed. The worrying thing is I come home at night into my room, and there on my bed is a Liverpool bedspread. They've taken it a little bit far. Now, are there some people here who are the parents of my new best friend from Liverpool? You know who you are. Jones. Are you Beth's parents? I love my Beth. I'm afraid I've kind of adopted her from you. So you can have her cross. Come and get it. This cross is for you. And you have produced the most wonderful daughter in the world. And I don't just say that in passing. How often do I talk about Beth, Chris? Lovely seeing you. We must see each other after. You get all of my books free. you're the only one. Okay? So, this is part of what Jesus calls us to. He says it's no good for you just to know the theology. You need to know the theology as well, but you need to demonstrate it. You need to demonstrate. And that's what Jesus is talking about. Feeding the hungry, ministering to the sick, visiting the prisoner. Those are the things that I have done throughout my ministry in the Middle East. I started off as a student in Israel. I went to yeshiva in the ultra-Orthodox rabbinical learning place. And I was the first goy they'd ever had, first Gentile, and the last. But the rabbi who taught me is still my rabbi. To this day, we always take him out for dinner. Always do everything with him. Bethan's coming to Israel with me, isn't she, in the summer? And she will go to my rabbi. She's really exciting. And so this ministry in a place of conflict is about loving, loving, and loving. Loving your enemies. It was Longfellow, the poet, who said, "Who is my enemy? It is the person whose story I have not heard." And so much of our work is about enabling people to tell their story, enabling people to declare who they really are. The very essence of my work is listening to people's stories. I was saying earlier today, we first started listening to the stories of the Shia and the Sunni, these various extremists. And I thought, we've got a whole 3 days. We should be able to hear each other's story. No. Next month I came back for another 3 days. No. Next month, 3 more. Next month, 3 more. Next month. It took 3 years for them to really tell their stories. And then it got to such a stage where I was working in Baghdad and Jerusalem. And I so wanted somehow to bring them both together. And people looked at me and said, "You're mad. The Israelis hate the Shia, the extremists you work with. And the Iraqis hate the Zionists." So I thought, I prayed. My best friend in life has also given this lecture before. He's called Jejun. He's from Cyprus via, where's that place? Chorley Wood. Via Chorley Wood. He's really a Chorley Wood Quiggly Lane boy. But he said, take them both to Cyprus. So I went to all of these people. Ayatollahs, I need you to come and meet with the chief rabbis with me in Cyprus, not in Israel. Chief rabbis, I need you to come and meet with the Ayatollahs with me. Not in Israel, don't worry. And they all told me how evil the other were and how terrible and how they never wanted to see them. We got them together, and after 3 days, the chief rabbi said, we've been here 3 days. I've got 3 words to say. Fear is cancelled. The Ayatollah said, I came here hating you. I saw your face. I heard your story. And I love you. That was the beginning of it. The process is still going on. And people always say to me, how on earth do you keep going? How do you manage to do all this work? Just now, before we started, somebody was talking to me about Bunyan. Was it you? What a story. Pilgrim's Progress. Do you remember when he came to the Palace Beautiful? And he came to the Palace Beautiful, and he said to the beautiful young lady, I think it was Prudence, who opened the door. She said to him, by what means art thou annoyances vanquished? In other words, how do you keep going when the going gets tough? And he said, when I look at what I saw on the cross, that will do it. And when I look at the word which I carry in my bosom, that will do it. And when I think of whitherest I'm going, that will do it. When we remember what we saw at the cross, when we look at the scroll we carry in our bosom, and when we think about where we are going, that will do it. That will do it. Somebody asked me today what was my favorite verse from Scripture. And I quoted a verse in Job. You wouldn't expect that, would you? Where Job is asked, what keeps you going? He said, before I had heard about you, Lord, I had heard your things, but now I have seen you. It's fine to have heard the story, but we need to see our Lord. We need to see whitherest we are going. You get the final cross. And remember why. Okay, I've got to shut up now. And then I can take lots more questions. And the principal said, if you can finish earlier rather than later, that's better. And I'm a subservient student. After my little child told me at school, I had to shut up. Was that okay, principal?
That's absolutely fine. Thank you very much.